Welcome to the testing sessions. I'm happy someone joined. They're like cool sessions on Parallel. I have a good news. You will not see any PowerPoint slides in the next 40 minutes. I have a bad news. For the next 40 minutes, you have to look at Android Studio and watch me coding, basically, because what we're trying to do is like a live coding session, which you should never do, because what can possibly go wrong, right? Like, run no test found, who knows this error. I also have one of these new MacBooks, so half the keys are actually falling off. So I will hold them up if this happens, so that you know why I'm getting slower. I did something like this like 2 years ago at DroidCon Berlin. It was basically the same topic. And I was showing like some basic, Kotlin was pretty new for most developers back then, some basics for Kotlin testing. And I repeated it, it went well, it was my first live coding ever, and didn't do it since then again. So I thought it's time. Things changed in Kotlin, we have coroutines and things like this. As we only have 40 minutes, I will just go through some basics and then we jump into coroutines. And so we'll talk about mocking, we'll talk about coroutines, test coroutine context and things like this. So this is what you can expect. A few words as an introduction for my beautiful slides. I'm Danny. And I'm from Berlin, Germany. This is the first time I'm in Paris. This is the first time, obviously, that would make us then. So we have to do a selfie. So please say hello. A bit more enthusiasm for testing, please. Okay, I'm a Google developer expert for Android and Kotlin, and I work for a company called Sport Total, which you probably never heard of, which is totally fine. We do sports streaming for what we call under-medialized app, like sports. It could be like amateur football, but it could be things like field hockey that no one would ever watch on TV. So we bring them live and we do like a bunch of cool stuff there. We are not yet in France, so you will hear from us hopefully soon. I do Kotlin since roughly 2016. Normally I tell this point the story, how I ended up Kotlin. Basically, it was a conference in Berlin. It was 2016, so before like the whole AO announcements, and I was happy to talk to the right people. Sometimes we are in this bubble, right, in the social bubble, where we only talk to like-minded developers or like-minded people, and I had to reason I'm the last person on Earth not using Kotlin. And someone told me, hey, we're using Kotlin, we don't tell our clients, it's not 1.0 yet, but we're using it. So I went back to work next day and I said to my colleague, hey, we are a two-person team, want to use Kotlin? He said, sure. And that's how we started. It wasn't always that easy later when I switched company, but yeah, I love Kotlin. And what we want to talk about, testing. So before we start, some of my favorite quotes, just to get you into it. I mean, you all probably love tests, right? Who here writes unit tests? Huh? Awesome. So Michael Feather said, like, code without tests is bad code. And this goes very in line with his most famous quote is, any code without test is legacy code. Why is this, right? So you can have like his most beautiful code that you ever think and you push it and Michael Feather said, that's legacy, sorry. And I'm happy that you write unit tests, so you probably know that the reason we write tests is not to prove that our code is working, which what a lot of developers think in the beginning. But it's not about this. I can run the code right, I know it's working. You're writing this code for yourself in 2 weeks, in 2 months, in a year, for the next developer on this project, right? And you're writing this for the refactoring that you will do then. So Martin Fowler said, refactoring without good test coverage is changing shit. So this is why we write the tests. In the end, they're like, this is not a quote, but they're the only documentation that basically lives with your code. You can write all your fancy Google Docs, you can write all these Java docs. The moment you push it, it's probably already outdated. Which is different with tests. And Uncle Bob once said that probably your test code is more important than your production code, because you can recreate the production code from the test, but not the other way around. So that's all the introduction. Let's dive into some tests, right? I think I prepared an empty class. So when I did this the first time, someone said, I love this TDD approach that you're doing there. And then afterward, I said, like, but I'm not doing TDD. Because there are a bunch of classes that we will test, but we will not look at them at all. So all we will see is the test. And this is kind of a TDD approach probably, but it's more like an exploratory testing that we'll try to do here. So this is how I normally start. I mean, I probably wouldn't call it first test, but something else. But I would indeed call my first test test, because normally when I started, I have no idea what I'm going to test. As I'm working for a sports streaming app, the classes that I created for this presentation are all a bit about around sports. So let's start. The class that I'm testing, I normally call tested. So some, I don't know, there's a Coursera course about testing. They use SIT, system under test. I'm not a big fan of abbreviations, but that's also good. The rule is just make this field or this variable sound a bit different so that it's very easy to spot which one you're testing, right? So I have a class called tournament somewhere. There it is. And let's, okay, I want to test this class. Let's start with something very simple. So this class. How about has matches? That sounds good. I don't do anything, so has matches should be false, right? So I have came up with my first test, because you have to add teams and matches to a tournament first. So how would we test this? Normally we would use like assert false, right? So I could write something like, whoop, this is not what I wanted to do. So we could use assert false, right? Like false, false, there it is. I don't know, for some reason my Android Studio is very slow. This never happened before. I actually just resaw this. But you know, this is the old school JUnit way we would do it, right? If you're using Espresso, you're probably using something like Hemcrest. When I was still in Java, I was using the fast assertions. I really like those. If you're now doing testing of Kotlin, you should also reevaluate the assertion libraries that you're using. My favorite is a thing called Cluent. And Cluent has these really nice methods that use like this backtest annotation. So I can say, this message should be false. And this reads really, really nice. And now I give this also a nice test name. And I use backtext there as well. So should have. So when you're in presentation mode, IntelliJ is much slower than without. Should have no matches, right? Initially. I will leave with them initially. And then maybe you just do some refactoring. I mean, we should do it after the test. But now we have a really nice test. So the ideal test has like one line, maximum three, right? When given when then. But this reads really nice. Should have no matches. Maybe initially we should add. And then you have this. And I love Cluent. So Cluent has these nice backtick methods. It's basically an infix method. So you could also write it like this. If you've never seen this, this is the same thing. Come on. This is the same. If you never used a method like this, I would not use it for my Android app. Actually, it will not work because the DEX format does not support this. When Jack Wharton joined Google, he said it's the first thing he's going to fix. It's not fixed yet, and I think he gave up, but he told the team what to do. But we're still waiting this, as far as I know. But you can use it for the JVM test, right, which is really nice. And in the end, your tests are your documentation, so really make nice sentences out of this. If you use JUnit 5 and you don't want to use, there's an @DisplayName annotation that basically you can do the same. Write a nice sentence, and then when you run your test, you would see this. But let's write something else, just to see what else is included. Let me be lazy and just add it to the same method. So, for example, there's a getMatches method, or like a getTeams. So assume, as it's a bit slow, I will not add it. So I will now, in the given, would say, hey, tested.addTeams. And then afterwards, I could check, hey, these teams are in there. But maybe let's do it, because otherwise, you have to believe me what I'm doing here. OK, you can add a team here. So let's add one team. Let's call it France. Let's add another team. Let's call it Germany. Right, not sure how I came up with those names. Come on, Germany. Cool. So we have two teams, and now I would, for example, could check, hey, that get teams, I mean, it's a very stupid test, should contain something like Germany. How would you test this? I mean, you could ask for the list, right, and use contains, and use another assertion around this. But Cluent has some nice method, and some were just added recently. That's why I want to show this. So they have should contain all, that takes a list. They have should contain some. So you give them a list of some things, and if some of them matches, it's already green. Should contain none. Should contain the same. So I really love some of those, and then you could, for example, give them a list of, I don't know, Germany. Maybe a team, because otherwise it will not work. So really have a look at the Kluent library. I mean, we use it all over the place, but there are other assertion libraries there for Kotlin. Let's look at something else. Let's move it a bit. Let's write a second test. You know, there's one thing that I never liked when it came to JUnit, at least when it was JUnit 4, which was if a code throws an exception, the way we need to handle this. So I know that, let's say the spec said it, that when you ask for matches without adding anything, it will throw an exception. How do I test this? Normally, by the way, does anyone know if I'm using JUnit 4 or 5 here? Yes, it's 5. You can only tell by I'm using the Jupyter import. So in JUnit 4, I would now open a bracket here and say expected. JUnit 5 does not have this anymore because it was always bad. Why? We try to write our test in a way given when, then. Range, act, assert, or whatever your terminology is. But if you want to check for an exception, you basically have to put the exception first, which messes up the whole flow. Happily, we have better ways to do this now. There are basically one that comes with Kotlin and one that comes with JUnit 5. They're basically the same thing. So there is an assert fails. Assert fails with. So this is the one from Kotlin test. So you all have this if you're using Kotlin. And then I could say, for example, illegal argument exception. And then I put in this nice lambda block here. So this reads much better as it brings the exception it's going to throw in much closer to the actual code. It's still a little bit wrong, but it's much better than having it in the annotation. There's one from JUnit 5, which is, I think, called assert. Let me remove this, because otherwise the compiler will complain. Assert throws exactly the same syntax, so you can decide which one you like. So same thing. But there's one that I like even more. Which again comes from Kluent. So I give him first the lambda, and then I say, hey, this should throw an exception. And this looks really nice, because in the end, you can have a given, there's no given here, and there's a when tested get matches, should throw. So it keeps this flow all over, which I really like. Let's keep going. So this was Kluent. Who here uses pure Mockito out of the box, like the Java Mockito in your test? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Who uses Kotlin Mockito? Who uses Mock-K? Who doesn't use mocks at all? Well, mocks are a bad thing, although we all use them, right? We should at least try to reduce them. It's a bit like alcohol. So let's write a test. So let's quickly talk about mocking. Oh, I already have this awesome name test. Okay, you know. I will do something that I would never do. Let's do test 2. Let's focus on what we want to test. I want to mock something, so I have an interface here. I know it exists. It's the sponsor. So I will show you the interface in a second. So the old school Mockito way would be something like this. So I would say mock the sponsor class dot, yes, it's the this one, class dot, and then I have a sponsor. And then, for example, when I have to do the when for Mockito, as when is a keyword, it has this ugly back tag, and then I could do something like, hey, when sponsor, I don't know, is premium, then return true. I mean, this is the way we kind of use it, right? And if you use Mockito out of the box, this is the way you see it. I never liked this because it kind of got uglier, although we have a nicer language now with Kotlin. So what I'm using is Kotlin Mockito, which is basically just a thin layer around Mockito. And let's rewrite this to the to Kotlin Mockito. So it has generic rewrite, and looks nicer. And to overcome this when thing, they have a whenever. Looks very similar, but already much nicer with the generics. We can make this even more Kotlin-like, because this is still kind of Java-ish. So the way I would write this, and then it goes into what Mock-K uses, I can write something like this. So basically, you give them a lambda, and then you can program your whole mock. Why is this a nice thing? Because now you could, for example, move this out and make it a field. Because often we have like fields that we initialize for multiple tests. What I don't like is having a field declaration, and then you have a setup method where you set them up, and it all gets a bit like, it's hard to see what actually happens. With this way, you can have one line without needing like an apply block or something. So I think this is really nice. So have a look at this. Mockay has similar, they also work with a lot of lambdas. And we'll talk about both a bit later. Is there something else we should look at the mocking? I think let's jump into coroutines now. I mean, we could look into like argument capture and stuff like this. There's a lot of nice things in there. But I want to talk about coroutines. So who here is using coroutines? Okay, half the audience, nearly. There was some really nice presentation by Luis, for example, this morning, showing us a bit, maybe there was where in the workshop by Florina. So our code base, we have a little bit of like Java, we have a little bit of coroutines now, so they're not competing actually. Like, but for example, our retrofit, we already went to coroutines, they're really nice. But when it comes to testing, testing concurrency is hard. Concurrency is hard, and testing concurrency is even harder. So let's look at some things where we would run things that we would run into when using coroutines. So I have a class, and it's another interface. It's called a life game. So let's create one of those by just mocking it. I will not show you the class, but we can look at the method it has. So this game has two methods. Basically, a start broadcasting, which takes a deferred Boolean, and then they actually broadcast, which is a suspend method because it will block, right? So think about this, I call this, and then for the next 90 minutes, our game is broadcasted live, and then you can watch it for our app, something like this. So we have two coroutine related methods here, one is suspend, one is deferred. If you've never heard of coroutines, deferred is something like future in Java, but let's look at the suspend one. So if I want to call this, the compiler said, no. You can only do this from a suspend, from another suspend function, or you have to be in a coroutine. Sadly, what I cannot do is this. I cannot make suspend fun here, because then actually JUnit will not run this anymore. The reason behind this changes the signature, actually. I think when you look at the compiled code, you will see it returns an object and takes another continuation argument, and JUnit is confused. It would be actually nice to open this an issue for JUnit 5. Maybe there's a way to solve this. We should suggest that. Because actually JUnit 5 has some Kotlin code already in there to make it nicer. So what you normally would do in tests is something like this. You would use the run blocking, and then you can actually call this, because this creates a coroutine. Okay, this is nice, but I also need to set up this mock, right? So let's do whenever game.start broadcast, then return true. And again, oh, I can't call this because I need to be in a coroutine. Okay, let's do run blocking. That's fine. And then you do maybe later, I mean, it's a very stupid test, but let's, we want to do a verify on the game. And you want to check that broadcast is called. Oh, you, hey, you have to be in a coroutine. Okay, let's do run blocking. That looks already ugly, right? We wanted to have three lines, and what do we end up here? And if I even try to use this on, this will not. This will be even worse. It will not work at all without writing really weird code. So, what's the way we can solve this? What a lot of developers are doing, they basically move this up here. So it's kind of hidden. And let's remove this, and this, and this, and this, and we've okay. So I have the run blocking here, and then the whole thing is basically. In a coroutine. It's just very hidden. Maybe you see that this is now a bit grayed out, because this test doesn't return unit anymore. But at least for JUnit 5, it needs to be unit, so if I will run this, it would not run. And then awesome, we have a test that doesn't fail, but also doesn't run at all. So worst way of fixing this is something like this. Okay, let's add unit in the end. What we tend to use, for them, we could have our own, like maybe blocking test, and then let's just write it, although this is not the way we will solve it. So we can create a function blocking test that takes a function, and then we would do here return run blocking and call this function, and this is actually suspend. And this returns, yeah, still the same thing, right? Because we need to return unit. No, this was the wrong point. We wanted to return unit here. Okay, now it would work. Cool. But this is, we don't need this. We don't want this. Actually, let's go back to run blocking. What a lot of developers didn't know is that run blocking actually can take generics. You can solve it with this. You can tell run blocking what it actually will return. This is really nice. So issue solved, you test once. But as I told you, like this Java-ish way of writing this, of programming this mock, we don't want, right? We want the cool way. We want like on, what was it called? Broadcast, do return. And now we have a problem. Oh, by the way, I told you, this is the E key. From now on, I can program without E. Try to put it back. Okay. Let's hope it holds for the rest of the told you, right? Whatever can, what can go wrong in a live coding session? So this does not work, although we are in a run blocking call, because we are in a different context here, and this is what would be really hard. Which brings us to something, and the reason why you should look into Kotlin Mockito or into MockK, because they actually have some method that are specifically made for coroutines. So let's remove the run blocking and use like the methods we should use. So there is an on blocking you can use. Cool. And the run blocking, I mean, if you want to call it, you still need the run blocking, right? But for the verify, there is a verify blocking. The only thing we have to change is it takes a lambda now. So there's on blocking, there's verify blocking, and a few others, and we can use those. If you use MockK, there is the same method that starts with CO, so there's co-verify, for example. So look at those, because it reads much better, and we have much more control what is actually blocking or not, which is the next thing we will probably look at soon. What if we want more control than just one like run blocking call? But first, let's look at this deferred method, right? So this was easy. This was the suspend method. But let's look at the other one. There was one that, so let's remove all this. Okay. So there was another method here that was returning a deferred. Oh, the E doesn't work anymore. Thank you. So this method, I want to program my mock to return something there. So I do whenever game dot start broadcasting. Shit, I now need a deferred boolean, not a boolean, right? Okay, my first idea here was, you know, async returns a deferred too. Let's use global scope, which sounds bad already, right? Let's do this. And then we could hide the global scope async into like a nice extension function called toDeferred or something. It will actually work. We could use this. But there's a problem here, like a slight problem. There's one thing you don't want in your unit test, that something kicks off in parallel and might still run when your test already finished. Like all the tests should run in isolation. This is one of the basic ideas of JUnit. And the global scope async might kick something off. There's no side effect here, but what if it something more complex, right? So this looks at least a bit suspicious, and there's a better way of doing this. So what you can use is a class called, I still have like a weird E here, deferred. And there's the E key again. Okay, maybe I tried without E key. Deferred compl, oh, come on. Was it completable deferred? So this is totally safe to use if you need to move something into a deferred state. So completable deferred comes in the Kotlin test. Actually, it comes from the coroutines directly. Perfect. So we can use this. Let's look at the next thing. How about, so one thing that suspend function have differently from something like a deferred or something that returns a job is that we can cancel them, right? So, and now let's try to test that maybe make more sense. So how assume we want to test something and make sure that the cancellation actually works. So what we could write is something that we can cancel. Gesundheit. How do you say this in French? I learned Russian in school. I never spoke, don't speak French. Okay, whatever. That thing. So I'm having an interface called a live game. That we just used, right? So this is the one that we just looked at, right? The broadcast and the start broadcasting. There's actually an implementation. That's what I wanted to use. It's called a simple game. It just implements this. And I need a match. Okay, let's create a match. And I'm very creative with names. So let's do Germany. with those friends and create this simple life game. Will be a really good game, right? So what I now want to test is that when I call start broadcasting, and I keep this, and then I cancel this, that then afterwards he will never call the actually broadcast, because that's actually what simple game will do. It's a very simple implementation. It just does an async block called broadcast, right? Let's go back. So I want to make sure that he never calls this. So verify blocking. Yeah, we just learned about this one. Game never. Yes, this one. And I want that he never calls the broadcast. This will not work yet because this is not a mock. I will do something really ugly. I add a spy around it. That's actually code smell. If you need a spy, you probably did something wrong. But someone wrote this code, so I want to test it now. Because in the end, you're testing mostly implementation details, right? This is why spies are not probably the best thing. But for, so that's what I want to do. Call start broadcasting, call cancel, and then make sure that actually he never starts the broadcasting. So let's run this test that I should give a better name than test 2. And let's see, will it run? Will it be successful or not? Actually, it works. But when you think about it, wait. So start broadcasting calls an async. It starts a coroutine. When does this get executed? So I call cancel afterwards, but is there maybe a moment where there could actually be the other way around? Might this lead to a flaky task that might be green sometimes and might be red the other times? Always on CI, of course, it will fail. So yeah, someone knows this issue. So let's write this in a better way. So I think we need to control the execution of this coroutine. And this is the important thing when it comes to testing and what we have to keep in mind when you write code that uses a coroutine. The nice thing is that whoever wrote this game class, he gave me the possibility to actually, let's write this, match equals, to actually overwrite this. So there is a second parameter here, which is the coroutine context. So let's use one, and let's use one that you might have heard before, dispatchers.unconfined. I will explain you, if you have never heard of it, what this is in a second. So the game takes, show you this, takes a dispatcher, like a coding context, and uses dispatcher default, but I can override it in my test. And now the test breaks, which is perfect, because that's what I want. We always want a red test first. So we call start broadcasting, and then canceling, right? And then you want to verify. What unconfined does is what in RxJava was the trampoline scheduler. So documentation will tell us the same. It's a coroutine dispatcher. You always need a coroutine context. A dispatcher is a context, not the other way around. So it's a coroutine dispatcher that is not confined to a specific thread, and it executes initial continuation of the coroutine on the current call frame. So let's look at this again. So I call start broadcasting, start broadcasting, does async, and I'm on unconfined, so it just keeps going. Okay, sure, async. Okay, call broadcast. So the moment this is done, the whole thing is done. So when I call cancel, it's of course too late. This is really good to not have a flaky test, but this is not what we wanted to test initially, right? So we need something different than the unconfined. And there's something that is in there, that is test coroutine context that we can use here. It's yellow because it's deprecated. We will talk about this. So test coroutine context actually does the complete opposite. And if you're used to RxJava, this is like the test schedule on RxJava. So it basically doesn't do anything until you tell him to. So let's extract this into a variable, the test coroutine context, because I need it. What? No, no, no. Cool. So I call the start broadcasting. This doesn't do anything because test coroutine will just stand still. And then I say, OK, now trigger the action. So whatever was you're waiting on, do it now. Then I cancel, and then I verify blocking. So this test should fail now because it's before the cancel. Perfect. So I know it's working. Now we'll just move, switch those two blocks, run it again. Again, always have a failing test first. That's like a nice TD rule, because otherwise you don't know if it actually works. Cool, this works. So with trigger action, it's like a flush of your scheduler. You can use this. Before I explain a bit like why this class is deprecated, let's look at a more sophisticated example. Because the reason this is deprecated is structured concurrency, which we basically got recently in coroutines when they became final, which is when everything changed, right? Like all the information out there, especially about testing, is a bit outdated because they don't take into account structured concurrency. The bad thing is the test routine context was meant for the world before. And as always, they didn't have time to update the testing, so they said, we'll do this later. But actually, you can use it for most cases. But there's already pull request open, and I think it's already merged that will solve this, and we'll look into this in a second. For structured concurrency, I will take a different example. I have a class called ImageFilter that I will instantiate. And if you've been to the talk of Lewis today, or if you looked into Roman's examples of structured concurrency, you have seen this, because it has this nice method that is exactly this in this block, and he had it today. So this this class image filter has like an image loader that I added. And in the end, what it does, it uses the coroutine scope to create like a local coroutine scope. Roman did this to kick off two things in parallel. Then it's two coroutines, starting with the async builder, that load an image. So you give an image name here, badly named, by the way. Should be name one and name two, at least. And then it combines these images after waiting on them. So two async coroutines, we wait on them, then we call combine. I had to do something for the testing, so my combine is really simple. It waits for 3 seconds, and then returns a new image made out of the two image names that comes in. Should be enough for testing now. So let's go back to our test and put the E key back one more time. Come on, back to the test. Here we go. Okay, I want to call this method image filter, load and combine, give it two images. Okay, now this is a coroutine, this is a suspend function, so I need to put it in the coroutine. What I want to test here is basically see the whole flow a bit more and control it a bit more. So I could use one blocking, but this will not bring me closer to this goal because I want to control it with the test coroutine context that we just saw. So also, there was a delay of 3 seconds in there. We don't want to wait 3 seconds in your test because this could be even 90 seconds or something, right? Tests need to be fast. This is the first rule of unit test. Second rule is they should be even faster. Okay, what can we do? How about using launch? So with launch or async, I can kick off a coroutine, and then I get like a job back, and I can use this, right? But I need a scope. So I told you there's coroutine context, then there's a dispatcher, which is a coroutine context, and there's the other thing called coroutine scope. And every coroutine basically uses two things. It uses the scope and the context and puts them together. And actually, scope is just a wrapper around context. If this sounds confusing, it is a little bit. But actually, it all makes sense. So I need a coroutine scope to launch it. I don't want to use global scope here. One thing you should do in your test, which is really nice, you can let your test implement coroutine scope. Test one for themselves, this is fine, because by implementing it, you're exposing some methods. And I implement as a member. Yes, and I will make it very simple. I will just initialize it with the test coroutines context. Cool. And okay, so coroutine scope only has one method. Give me the context. Basically, it's this this field that you have to implement. And I said, okay, this is the test one that we just used. And now that I'm a context, I'm allowed to call something like launch or async without having to tell him any more details. So we can do this. Okay, now we kick off something. If we would do this, test coroutine context doesn't do anything, right? So what we have to do is trigger detection. And now think what the test does. So we have a launch here, then we have two asyncs, and then we have a delay, and all have to come together. So trigger action will not help us here. What we can do is another thing, so we have to at least forward the scheduler by 3 seconds. So that's very easy to do. Coroutine context has a method for this. It's called advance time by time unit seconds. So basically, the nice thing, like with Rx schedule, you completely can control the time. You can ask what's the queuing time. There's advanced time by and advanced time to. And this way, I can move this. And so he will change the queuing time and then do the trigger action, which is the thing that we used before. So now this test will probably be green. But What did we test here? Nothing. I think we should have at least some assertions. So one thing you should do when it comes to coroutines that you kick off like this, that you're not using run blocking, make sure they're actually complete. Because otherwise you might have side effects that you overlook. This is very easy to do. Like every job and deferred actually has a, is completed. So this should be true. Now we can see that actually this advanced time by does actually work. Cool. I still don't really have an assertion. I just know that the whole thing completed. And it completed in 140 milliseconds, not 3 seconds. This is what we wanted to do, right? So let's check the return here. So I told you that my combine just combined the two names. So I'm expecting here this should be 1, 2. But you know, I will always should have a red test first. So let's assume, hey, this should be 1, 3, just to make sure this text actually works. I run it, it will be red. It's not. Anyone any idea what's the problem here? Cool, at least you will learn one thing from the talk. What happened is that we have an assertion, it throws an assertion error, which is an exception. So in one of the coroutines that we spin off, an exception is thrown, and that's where it is. It doesn't get rethrown here with the test coroutine context into the main thread. We know this like from code, right? One thread is crashing and your whole application takes down, but it is not the thread that we are in, so the unit test is fine. So something in parallel crashed. So what we have to do is, when you use the test scheduler, it's very easy actually, because it has another nice thing. You can ask them for all the exceptions that happened during execution. And then I do something really simple. If there was any, just throw it. So I will re-throw the exception wherever it came from into the current block. Hey, cool, 1.3 does not match 1.2, so we could fix this now. But you know, I will change this async, this launch, to async. Will not change much. One is deferred, one returns a job. They're very similar, right? So it didn't change anything else. Let's run this test. It will fail, right? Then it's green again. What happened now? Async behaves a little bit different than launch. And you have to be aware when it comes to testing. And this, now we go into the structured concurrency. Basically, if an exception happens in one of the coroutines, with async, it will not bubble up. It will stay where it is. But there's a really nice way to check this. So this will not have any exceptions. It will be empty. But we can use another one. And this is actually not only a testing method. It is always there. There's get completion exception on null. This comes back on job, on deferred. Async returns a deferred. So we can write something like this. So if there's an exception, or if this does not complete, which makes the other test that we had obsolete, so we can get rid of this, and we can get rid of this. And now we can run it again. Then I will rethrow it. So if there, it will give me an exception that was not completed, or if there was an exception. So I just rethrow it, and this is exactly the one we wanted. So really be aware of this, and this is when it comes to concurrency. Really make sure you have a red test first, because maybe everything is green, and you didn't even notice that you're not testing anything. But I know, you know, this example, not this one, the load and combine wasn't complex enough, right? So let's look, I made it even more complex. So I took the same and called it load and switch and combine. We do the same thing, coroutine scope, two asyncs, image loading. Then I'm waiting on both, but then I'm doing a context switch in the I/O dispatcher, and then I do the combine image, which was the one that we waited on, right? So let's try to test this one. I will stick with the async, in the end it doesn't matter. So load and switch and combine. So let's run this. And it didn't complete. Makes sense, right? Because the advanced time by is now happening on the wrong dispatcher. And now we happily, whoever wrote this image filter, thought about this and makes the test, make this testable with a pattern that we also, a lot of us using for Rx Java. So one of the things I can overwrite here are the dispatchers. So I will show you in a second how I do this. And this is something you should keep in mind when it comes to coroutines. Test coroutine dispatchers. So I create this interface and we use it similar like this with like default IO main, the ones that I want to use. There's an implementation that uses default IO and main that I normally use. It's a default argument. And I have one that just uses test coroutine context. And this is the one I'm giving in now. Let's extract it to a variable. And now we can just change this coroutine context to testcoroutinedispatches.io. No advance, the right one. This will still not compile, because now we have to look at the flow a bit. So we have async, which happened in the current thread. Then we go in, there was two more asyncs, right, in the coroutine scope. Then we are doing the delay on the new I.O., and then we are basically going back. So if you want to test this, and now it gets really complicated, kind of, we still have to trigger the action, so the first asyncs, and then being back on a current thread, and now we should be fine. Cool. So we use the test coroutine context here, and we use this one. I mean, of course, we could initialize them all to the same, but then we don't have control. So when would you use something like this? When you really want to see what's going on. For example, we have some Redux implementations, and we want to make sure, okay, this is now good to store. This goes now there, this goes now there. If you want to have something like this, maybe you want tests that really make sure step by step what the implementation is. Normally, you shouldn't care, right? Just flush and make sure that the result is the right thing. As we're running out of time, one word to test coroutine dispatches, test coroutine context. This is deprecated. And the reason is structured concurrency, but there is something new already in preparation, as I told you. It's a pull request that you can find under the issue number 541 that splits this context up first into a dispatcher, an exception handler, and a scope. Because maybe you realize that sometimes I need a dispatcher and I gave him the context, so it's all very messed up in the test coroutine context. It's like this one God class. Also, there's a delay control on exception capture, so also this exception handling in the structured concurrency is better with this. There's a builder called run blocking test. If you ever use with test context, just forget about it. It's pretty useless. They've removed this now also. So have a look at this. I think it's now merged, so it will be, should be there soon. But it was a long going on discussion. It's very interesting to see. They wanted to get it right, but a bit sad that it's a bit late. But test coroutine context actually works. And it's just deprecated. You can still use it for a while. There's one more thing. A lot of libraries and a lot of code uses the main dispatcher. So internally, you see it a lot of in Google Code. I'm not looking at anyone here. But maybe that's when Google's in. They just use dispatcher.main. Which makes it impossible to test. That we have already something that was merged a while ago. There is a dependency called Kotlin coroutines debug. If you have this, this was the issue before, you can actually overwrite the main dispatcher. So there is an extension method on dispatchers called setMain, where you can give them a dispatcher. It needs to be dispatcher. You cannot give them test coroutine context. This is why we need a dispatcher for this. But you can give it I.O., default, whatever, right? So you can redirect it and make sure you change it afterwards, right? Like in a teardown. That's it. I think we ran out of time. So let me have a final end slide here. Thank you. And yeah, so make sure you control all your coroutines and move like all the players on the field. Do we have time for questions, or should we take it after? Okay, no time. So then, Ben Weiss, I think, is the next one here.